A good mathematical model of the spread of an infectious disease is extremely important, especially in the case of a pandemic like COVID-19. Such a model allows to predict the number of infections as a function of time. Furthermore, it can be used to predict the impact of governmental measures like closing down parts of society. This is very important because these measures can be extremely costly, so we want to know beforehand the potential benefit in order to weigh this against their societal costs. Fortunately, there is such a model. This is called the SEIR model. In this video, we'll learn how this model describes the evolution of an epidemic. As you will see, this model is not complicated at all from a mathematical viewpoint. There is one catch though, which we'll encounter at the end of this video. So, what is the idea of the model? We are going to split up the entire population into four groups as susceptibles. Susceptibles are people who have not yet gotten the virus. So initially, all people are in the group of the susceptibles. Then the E, the exposed. Those are the people who have contracted the virus, but are still in the exposure stage, so they are assumed not to be infectious yet. Then after several days, the exposed people will move to the group of infected people. Those who have the illness are infectious and are actually sick. And at a certain moment, people will move to the group of R recovered, which means that they are either recovered, they are not sick anymore, or they have diseased from the due to the illness. Then they are also put in the group recovered. From a mathematical perspective, there's no difference here. Then the total population N is of course a sum of S plus E plus I plus R, because you are either susceptible or exposed or infected or recovered. So the whole population is split up in those four groups. So initially everybody starts in the S group. Now I want to model how a transition from S to I to E to I to R can be modeled. We'll start with the last step. That's the easiest one. So how do you get how do you enter the R group? So this arrow over here. Oh. How do you go from I to R? So the number of people recovering is modeled to be proportional to the number of people that's infected and to the time. So if there are more people infected, more people will recover, and if you wait longer, more people will recover. So that's the basic idea. So delta I equals is proportional to I times delta t, and let's give this proportionality constant a name. Let's call it gamma. So then we have delta r is approximately equal to gamma times I times delta t. It's only exactly equal if you take your delta t small enough. So then we have dr dt equals gamma times I, where we have some unknown parameter gamma. However, we can estimate the gamma quite decently, because the gamma basically tells you how many people recover per infection per unit time. So your gamma is basically a 1 over the duration of your infection. So if you have like 100 people and the duration is 7 days, and on average per day 100 over 7 people will recover. So your gamma will be 1 over 7 then. So that's that error going from I to R. That's how you can end up in R. So how many people do we get in the group I? Well, you have inflow from E and outflow to R. So the outflow to from I to R gives you a delta I with a minus sign, minus gamma times I times delta t. So that's to balance it. People going to R are leaving the group I. And then you have another group. How many people enter I? Well, that is proportional to the number of people in group E and the time you're looking. And now we call this proportionality constant alpha. So delta I is approximately equal to minus gamma I times delta t plus alpha times E times delta t. Divide by delta t, take limits to zero, and we get a differential equation for dI dt. Minus gamma I to balance the plus gamma I for dr dt plus alpha times E. And similar to the gamma, we can also estimate the value of alpha. Alpha is more or less equal to 1 over the incubation period. So for alpha and gamma, we have pretty decent estimates. Then, final part. How do we end up in E? So that's actually the most interesting part, also the hardest. Of course, people leaving E are the people going to I, so minus alpha E times delta T. And you also get an influx from the group S. But how do you get from S to E? That's the, how are we going to model that? First of all, in the case of COVID-19, this is not known. So fortunately, we do not really need to know it exactly if you want to model this mathematically. So how do we do it? We introduce some parameter beta over here. And what's this parameter beta? It's the product of two terms, the number of contacts per person per day times the chance that if you have a contact from an S and an I person, you get an infection. Because how do you get your delta E then? It's the number of contacts per person per day times the number of days. So then you have the number of contacts, total number of contacts per person times S. Then you have the total number of contacts of the susceptibles times the chance that such a contact was with an infectious person times I over N. That's the chance that such a contact was exactly between an S and an I person, leading to an infection. So that is how you model your the EDT, the S beta times S times I over N. So to summarize, here we have our differential equations. We have our equation for the EDT. We saw the IDT and the RDT already. Of course, you can form the SDT. That's just what is entering the group. E is what is leaving the group S. So there you have your system of differential equations. Ordinary equation, so no problems there. You can solve, you can estimate your parameters alpha and gamma pretty well. So what's the problem? Well, the catch is in this parameter beta. That is actually not so easy to estimate. And moreover, to make matters worse, this beta may be time dependent, may show spatial heterogeneity. So if you just put some beta, solving this system is really easy. You can do so straight away. However, if you want to model reality, then you really have to be aware of this parameter beta, which because there you can run into trouble. So that is the catch. The catch is called beta here.